This afternoon, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, Mr. Anthony Barber, introduced his crisis budget. He called the situation today by far the gravest since the end of the war. The main details of the budget are these. First, government spending is to be cut back next year by £1,200 million. That's a cutback on new public spending of 20%. Second, there'll be higher purchase restrictions requiring a one-third deposit and a maximum repayment period of 24 months. There'll also be controls over other types of credit. There will be no increase in value-added tax. There'll be no increase either in income tax. But those on higher incomes will have to pay 10% more in surtax. And next, those who make profits out of the sale of development land and property will face taxation on their profits. Coming on top of the Prime Minister's statement last Thursday to deal with the energy crisis, in which he introduced the three-day week, what effect will this crisis budget have on the economy? Does it do anything to solve the miners' dispute? At this moment, union leaders are down in Whitehall talking to the new Secretary of State for Employment, Mr. William Whitelaw. There's little doubt they're discussing the crisis. To hear two views of the effects of today's budget, we have a leading industrialist and trade unionist. Sir Frederick Catherwood, Alan Fisher, can I ask you both, first of all, quite simply, do you see anything in what the Chancellor said this afternoon in the budget, Sir Frederick first, to prevent the three-day week beginning?
Well, the three-day week is mostly accounted for by the miners' strike. This is the immediate thing, and it really depends on whether the higher taxes on incomes, the surtax, and profits mean anything to the miners. They mean a lot to the people who have to pay them, so they better mean something to the miners, and I would hope that if this is the kind of thing they want, then it will affect it.
Alan Fisher?
Well, I don't see anything here that's likely to affect the imminence of the three-day week. I think the Chancellor today had a very great opportunity of trying to at least win some sort of cooperation from the trade unions if he had made out what could be called a social contract in this budget. But it seems to fall very far short of that, and the measures that have been proposed just don't seem to me to match up to a situation where it's said by the government that it's essential to have a three-day working week in order to solve our economic problems.
Well, can we look briefly at the likely economic impact? £12,000 million being taken out of the economy, Sir Fred. What effect is that going to have?
Well, I think it's too much. You see, I think the trouble is that the boom is on the turn, or the boom may well be bust at the moment, and everything is about to slide down. And they've done the classic thing that governments always do at the very moment when the boom goes bust. They put swingeing taxes on and things that won't really come into effect for about 9 or 12 months, just at the point at which they accelerate the slump when you want to come out of it again. And the trouble with this is that the public expenditure cuts take a long time to work through, and they will work through at the very time that we won't want them.
I should, of course, have said, I'm sorry, 1,200
yes,
million, not 12,000 right. million. Mm. What effect, then, do you think it's going to have?
Well, I think it'll have a very deflationary effect. I think the view of the CBI is that it shouldn't have been nearly so high as this, that it should have been a much lower figure, and I would have thought that they would have wanted, and certainly I would argue, for something much more flexible. I mean, the real problem at the moment is we're going on a three-day week, and this is caused principally by the miners. Now, hopefully, the miners will settle sometime in January. If they do, then a lot of this is quite unnecessary, and in fact you would want to go and do the exact opposite.
How do you explain, then, if you think it is so much too much, and if you think the CBI takes the same view, how do you explain the government making cuts of that size?
Well, it's like any government. They go on a binge for a while and they say nothing has changed when you get overheated, and then always and inevitably they turn around too late. And they turn around by too much, and all they do is make the slump worse when it comes. I don't know why they do this, but every single government for the last 20 years has done exactly the same thing.
It is one of the implications of what you're saying that it's now going to be almost impossible to avoid a slump of 1931 proportions?
Oh no, I'm not going for a slump of 1931 proportions. This is still and can be still held within the post-war framework. But if you're trying to get a sensible expansionist economy, which we must all still want, despite the oil crisis we still can have, then this is not going to help because of this enormous and very inflexible cutback on public expenditure.
Is not the possibility of expansion helped by the fact that there has been nothing taken out further in terms of corporation tax?
Well, no, I would have argued for something on corporation tax and for some food subsidy. I think food subsidy is terribly important at the moment to keep down the cost of living. And so far as corporation tax is concerned, the owners can afford this because they can see the thing through in the longer run. And I would imagine that it was perfectly possible to put a corporation tax on in the short run to help things and subsequently to take it off. But it's very difficult to reverse cuts in public expenditure.
Not long ago, you were talking about the possibility of 1.5 million unemployed.
That's right.
Is there anything today to make you think that that figure was exaggerated?
Not at all, but this, you see, doesn't really depend on the government. It depends on the miners. If the miners go back to work, then I think, as I said at the time, we can get by with the present cut in oil. And most people agree with this, and most industrialists say they can wear a 10% cut. If it goes up to a 20% or 30% cut in energy, then people will not be able to be employed, and a lot of companies will go broke into the bargain.
But there is unemployment, I suppose, implied, is there not, in the cutback in public spending alone of that order or not?
Well, I think that if you have a cutback in public spending, you certainly have higher unemployment, absolutely. But the point really is that there are two completely different things here. There is the government reversing its expansionist policy, which is a long-term or at least a year or a two-year thing, and there is the government taking immediate steps to deal with the miners. Now, their two immediate steps to deal with the miners are cosmetic. They are surtax and property profits. These mean a lot to people who have to pay surtax, and they may mean something to the property people. I'm not quite sure about that. If this doesn't help to settle the miners' dispute, then there is no point in doing them.
And you're saying it's cosmetic, and presumably the miners are as capable of seeing that something is cosmetic as you are.
No, it's
not. Is that what you're suggesting?
It's not cosmetic to me. I have to pay the higher surtax. It is not cosmetic, I think, to the property companies. But if this is written off as being cosmetic, then it's a fat lot of good because it doesn't bring in much revenue.
Alan Fisher, do you take the view that these cuts will have the effect that Sir Fred has suggested they will?
Yes, I go along with what Sir Fred has said, but I think that the government, quite frankly, has overreacted to the present situation. I think the idea that we've got to have in this country a three-day working week in industry, quite frankly, is uncalled for. And I can't help but suspect that what the government is doing here is that they are really playing a political game. And they are saying that really what's happened is that we failed in our efforts to keep the economy buoyant and to keep the economy in a satisfactory condition, and therefore we are now turning as a political expedient to blaming the miners. And I'm sure that this is a view that's taken in the trade union movement. And I don't see anything in the budget today which is going to help to solve what is essentially at the base of our problem here, and that is the dispute in the mining industry. I would have thought that the government's emphasis today ought to be on getting that dispute settled. Because if that dispute is settled, then I think with a 10 or 15% reduction in our oil supplies, we can get by and we can even maintain growth if the position is handled properly.
But let's have no illusion here that it is the miners go slow that is causing the three-day week or a four-day week or whatever is the right cutback. But the fact is that industry now cannot get supplies of basic materials like steel. And if you can't get supplies, this is the real world that we're living in. If you can't get supplies, then you are going to have layoffs. And it is the miners' dispute that is putting people out of work.
If we can come to how we deal with that in a moment, can I ask what, for instance, Alan Fisher, your members' reaction will be, you think, to the surcharge on surtax at 10%, to property owners being taxed more heavily?
Well, I think the reaction of my members to that is going to be, well, the surtax changes, as I understand them, are likely to bring in about £35 million. That's all. And this is absolutely peripheral. It has really nothing to do with the total problem with which the country is faced. It's a little bit of window dressing. And it compares very unfavourably with the £300 million that was given away in tax allowances earlier this year as a result of the government's previous budgets. So that's not going to cause much enthusiasm. Nobody's hat's going to be thrown in the air on that one. Dealing with the property speculators tax, it seems to me this again is only going to bring in 80 million. And if, as is likely, the value of property falls substantially, as I understand it is on the market at the moment, then it's likely these people who are the property dealers, the people who are the property speculators, are going to be putting in for capital losses, not capital gains, and they'll be asking for a reduction on their taxes as a result of this.
I think this is
something that's not going to be
You're not
really
saying that property taxation of this kind is irrelevant, are you?
I'm not saying it's irrelevant, but I'm saying the amount that's to be gained, if it can be gained through a lot of complicated measures, is not something that's going to set the country on fire, and it's not likely to encourage the unions to come to early settlement.
See, this is the irritating thing about all these things. You read a great build-up to them, that the miners are not going to settle and nobody else is going to settle, while the rich are getting away with it. And that by the rich, it always, of course, means the professional classes, not the really rich, and it always comes back on surtax and never on property or wealth. But then when somebody comes out with a tax which individual people have to pay and which costs them a great deal of money out of their earnings, it is then dismissed as an irrelevancy. Well, this is very irritating for the people who are now being put as sacrificial lambs for the maintenance of good relations. If it is as irrelevant as that, then why was there the colossal build-up beforehand and the request for these taxes to be put on?
Well, the answer to that one, I think, is that what was expected was far more meaningful steps on taxation, a far bigger attempt to redistribute incomes and wealth in this country in a meaningful way. What I'm saying is not that the idea of an additional surtax is wrong in itself or a property tax is wrong. What I'm saying is that the amount that these will bring in, the extent to which the taxes have been changed, is something that really in the present situation I would call irrelevant.
Well, can I go back to the point that Sir Fred made, which was that he hoped that people would realise, or that the workers would realise, that as a consequence of this surcharge on surtax, a lot of other people were being asked to bear the burden of the crisis. Do you not think that your members will think that as a result of this increase, that there are other people who are not working like themselves on low wages who are also sharing the costs of this situation?
Well, the cost of this situation is going to fall, first of all, on these people who are going on to a three-day working week, never mind about surtax payers, and a lot of people will be unemployed if this situation continues, and whether somebody pays 10% on their surtax, they wouldn't be able to afford to pay 10% unless they were earning an income that brought them in the surtax
But you
level.
See, this going on to a three-day week is not the responsibility of architects, civil engineers, chartered accountants, doctors, nurses, and all these people. Something has happened entirely outside their control, but within the control of the trade union movement, that is the miners' strike, for which they bear no responsibility, and as a result of which they're asked to pay higher taxes. Now, I think the professional people are happy to do this. What annoys them is when, having done it and being about to pay out large sums of additional money, they're told that the whole thing is an irrelevant cosmetic exercise. Either it matters or it doesn't. And as to the amounts, every single person who's ever studied the figures knows that the amounts that you get from surtax are absolutely derisory. There's no point in looking at the amounts. There isn't any money to be got there.
But I'd like to move on, if we could, there. A number of the commentators were suggesting that one of the key points of this budget had to be to get the balance of payments back down from its present figure of well over 2,000 million a year. Do you think that it does anything?
Well, I don't think it does an awful lot, quite frankly, because I would have expected a very substantial tax to be put on fuel oil. And if they'd put a substantial tax on fuel oil to discourage its use across the country, then this would have helped the balance of payments, and this should have been offset by some credit, some subsidy on food. And I would have thought that this was a major shift to help people to buy cheaper food and make petrol and oil much more expensive. And nothing like that has been done at all. So there's been no aim in here to help the balance of payments whatsoever.
Well, then you're making two very key criticisms. One is that there's been too much, so there's going to be too much deflation.
That's right.
And the other is it's going to do nothing about the balance of payments, or not a significant amount about the balance of payments.
I wouldn't have thought so. No.
Is there any possibility, Mr. Heath was talking on Thursday about the need to get exports going, is there any possibility that you see through what the Chancellor said today of beginning to get exports going in any way?
You cannot possibly get exports going till the miners go back to work. Steel has gone on 50% of its production. Everything we make practically that comes out of this country is made of steel. And how can you export more or ask anyone to export more until they can get the steel? And they can't do that till they can get the coal, because it needs a ton of coal to make a ton of steel.
Alan Fisher, do you think that your members, as they begin to experience the three-day week, as they begin to experience the HP cuts, will begin to urge the miners to settle?
No, I don't think they will. I think that workers in this country generally, and I think the unions in this country, recognise that the miners have got a special case. They recognise that anybody who has to go underground to do the kind of job that the miner is expected to do deserves every sympathy and deserves some practical help as far as pay is concerned. I mean, people say they wouldn't do a miner's job for £100 a week, let alone what the miners get now. And I think there is a general and a genuine sympathy on the part of trade unions for the miners as a special case. But if I may make the one point that I'd like to make, and that is the great failure of this budget, to my mind, is its failure to do anything about prices. It hasn't strengthened the Price Commission's powers, which are now very limited. It certainly hasn't done anything to restrict or control the prices of essential foodstuffs. It hasn't done anything in the way of subsidies. This is the one thing that I think the Chancellor could have done, which would have made a very deep impression on the trade unions.
Could I be a little bit more optimistic? If we do get a settlement of the miners' strike, and that is up to Alan Fisher and his colleagues, I think, in the TUC, but if we do this, then I think the outlook in the future is not too bad, because the oil crisis is going to reduce the output in most industrial countries, and this is going to reduce, in turn, all the raw materials that we have to buy that have made our balance of payments so awful. And I would have thought that we could have gone on quite well if the miners' strike is settled.
We come back again then, as always, to the miners' strike. Do you think that the TUC, as a result of this budget, as a result of the situation that's emerged since Thursday, since the three-day week, is going to attempt in any way to pressurise the miners into thinking about going back to work?
I don't think they'll want to pressurise the miners. I think that what the TUC will want to do here is to adopt what I think is its traditional role, and that is a role of mediation. What is worrying, I think, again about the Chancellor's statement today is he said that phase three is there, that nobody shall exceed phase three. There's a lack of a flexible approach. And I would have hoped that the government would have made a much more flexible approach to the miners' situation, which would have enabled then the TUC to have stepped in with the new Secretary of Employment, Willie Whitelaw, and have got a settlement of this grievous dispute.
Well, if it is the case that that phase three is to continue, that the government is going to stand firm, what is the TUC going to say, for instance, at next Friday's meeting of NEDI, the National Economic
Well, I think the TUC at the next meeting of NEDI will be putting forward the points of view that the TUC has consistently put forward. These are that there should be direct food subsidies, that these are essential in the present circumstances to protect people. They will be saying that they want to see something done for the lower paid, particularly for pensioners in the present circumstance, where prices inevitably are going to rise. If there's a lowering of production, if there's a three-day week, unit costs will go up, prices will continue to shoot up. And so the TUC will want something done there. They will argue, and I argued earlier on, that the tax changes don't go far enough. There is no genuine attempt to redistribute wealth, and that therefore the TUC will be restating, I think, their position as to the kind of steps they think are necessary in the present situation.
It seems, Sir Fred, if that is the case, that we're back where we were. I mean, we haven't advanced at all from before last week, from the last few months, in fact.
Well, I think we have advanced a little way. I think in the end, it will be the TUC who must take the miners on one side and say to them, look, you are putting our people out of work. Unemployment is now over 1 million and rising. And brothers, enough is enough. Now, whatever is said here, I'm perfectly certain that behind the scenes this is what they're going to do.
Can I ask you very briefly, what is going to happen if there is no settlement, if the TUC does not put that pressure on the miners, in your view?
Well, if they didn't, which I think is inconceivable, then obviously unemployment will go up from 1.5 million to 2 million to 2.5 million, but somewhere along the road they are bound to do it.
Can I ask you both very briefly, as Mr. Heath said on Thursday, the need for national unity was overwhelmingly clear. Alan Fisher, do you think that that unity is any closer today than it was on Thursday? Very briefly.
No, I don't. I think the government had a great opportunity here, and I think, quite frankly, they've missed it.
Very briefly, Sir Fred.
Well, I think that they've missed it too, but I would hope that that would not put the TUC off too much, because they've got to bear some responsibility, because they have the power, and with the power goes the responsibility.
Well,